Welcome to I'll Go If You Go, a Save the Redwoods League podcast. We're building community and illuminating how Californians from all walks of life think about and experience nature and conservation in the Redwoods and beyond. I'll go if you go, because when we explore together in community, the experience is all the more powerful. Join us as we talk with Tony Maggi Brown, a Humboldt University State Senior studying wildlife conservation, biology, and ecology. He shares how creativity and imagination have influenced the way he studies and relates to nature.
Thank you very much for having me here. It's an honor.
Thank you. So let's jump in and get to know Tony. How did your upbringing inspire your connection with nature and wildlife?
So I grew up in Southern California. I live in the suburbs, and growing up, I always had a lot of animals in my house. We had dogs, cats. We had a pond with turtles. At some point, we even had ducks outside. So I was just surrounded by a lot of pets, and I had a lot of opportunity to form connections with them. And in doing that, I was really seeing that they had emotions, they had intelligence. They just always captivated me. And a lot of my experiences were actually indirect experiences with nature, with what are called vicarious experiences. Video games was something that kind of took off my interest. And then I also watched nature documentaries growing up. And those were just incredible because of the way they told stories about animals. They were just like a whole book. And I wanted to go explore those and to do those myself. So that pushed me towards the path of going to Humboldt State University, where I wanted to study photography because I wanted to go around and take photos and videos of animals like I saw people do in nature documentaries. And then I started to research these photographers and videographers, and then I realized that they went to school for science. And I was like, what? They didn't go to school for photography like I'm doing? So I heard about the wildlife program in my school, and I wanted to learn more about that. So I talked to a counselor. It seemed amazing. I took an intro class. I loved it. And then ever since then, I'm like, okay, I'm learning all about animals now because, yes, I do want to go out and take photos of them, but like I have such an amazing resource around me to learn about animals. And so that's what got me to where I am now.
That's wonderful. Sounds like you've been able to combine both of your passions, photography and wildlife, into one. Mm-hmm. That's great.
Yeah.
Let's talk a little bit about the first time you stepped into a redwood forest. What was that experience like?
So I had never seen Humboldt State before I came to Humboldt State University. I had seen pictures of it and I had heard about it, but I'd never traveled up and I really had never seen a redwood forest or anything close to it until I started to travel up for the first time. My mom was taking me to college. And we came to this tree called the chandelier tree in Leggett, California. It's in Northern California. And it's just a massive tree, very tall, and it has like a 16-foot diameter. So just super wide. And it's a drive-through tree. So it's like a tourist attraction. It's like ecotourism. And then we drove through the tree. And that was just such a crazy experience. I got out of the car and my mom was driving through and I was like taking a video of her. She was like looking at the tree. And yeah, it's an incredible tree, but stepping back, I looked and just saw how tall it was and I couldn't even see the top. Like I couldn't even see the crown. And that just really blew my mind. It was like a skyscraper. So that was the first time that I had stepped into a redwood. And then I saw the redwood forest probably within my first or second day coming to Humboldt State University, because we have the Arcata Community Forest on campus, right behind campus. And I went there with some friends and really felt like I was in a different world. I felt so happy and just it was a start of my connection and my falling in love for redwood ecosystems.
Right on. Last summer, you were a Redwoods Rising Wildlife Apprentice. And for those of you listening, Redwoods Rising is a partnership project between Save the Redwoods League, the National Park Service, and California State Parks to restore entire landscapes in Redwood National and State Parks. Would you tell us your experience as a wildlife apprentice? What did your project entail?
So my project entailed so many different things. And just, yeah, like you said, Redwoods Rising, it's part of this big collaborative project. It had multiple agencies and multiple organizations, which was really, it is still ongoing. And it's really critical to that they're doing this, because those barriers of different jurisdictions, different ownerships of land, are what prevent a lot of these different land scale conservation projects from occurring efficiently. So I was welcomed into this major project to create the largest continuous stand of redwoods. And our first week, we were going out to set up cameras for carnivore monitoring. So we were monitoring Humboldt martens and Pacific fisher, but we were also just noting any other species we saw. And we were interested in other carnivores as well, like black bears and bobcats, which we did see on camera.
Cool.
Yeah. So we baited the cameras with chicken, and then we also had these hair brushes where we would have glue on them so we could collect some hair samples in case they brushed it. And the idea was that they would come, they would smell this this scent. It's called Gusto, and it's used for a lot of different baiting. And it is, it's basically skunk butt glands, like the gross, the gross smelly stuff about skunks. And they got that, and it's harvested sustainably and ethically and all that stuff. And then we would bait them there so that we could get an idea of how Humboldt martens and other carnivores were. And that was part of trying to measure the response of the project on these different carnivore populations, because Humboldt martens and Pacific fishers, these are populations that are in jeopardy because of the damage that's been done to these landscapes over the last 150 years with just logging and clear cutting and the devastation from large wildfires as well. So Save the Redwoods League and the whole project of Redwoods Rising, they're trying to restore this, and they actively are. And it's amazing. It's incredible to see the different things they're doing. And we were out there trying to measure the effect it was having to make sure that the restoration effect was having on animals, and other crews were working on plants. And we were trying to make sure that this is having the effect we want it to have. So in terms of my actual field duties, I also did land bird surveys, because they would be doing selective thinning, which is part of restoration thinning. And it's really awesome. And we wanted to make sure that when they send out the big trucks out to collect the different really thin trees, we want to make sure that any nesting birds in the area aren't disturbed and we don't have a large impact on them. So we would go through the roads before they would clear out the sides of the roads, and we would look for birds and we would look for the nests. And so I spent a lot of time walking down roads and just listening for birds for 10 minutes and walking again, just keep listening. But overall, I got to work on a lot of different projects. It was incredible. I got to use a lot of different wildlife tools and techniques that I've been learning in class for the first time. It's an incredible experience, and I'm really grateful for it.
Oh, well, that sounds wonderful. And I think we're really lucky to have you be part of that team. And I think also that for a wildlife conservationist like yourself, it must have been pretty amazing developing those relationships with the wildlife.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. Especially with the bird, the breeding bird surveys, since I had to learn all the different forest birds. Not all of them. There's so many different birds, but I had to learn some very common ones, and definitely ones that were endangered or threatened species are obviously kind of a priority. But I learned a lot of different bird calls, and I'd learned ways to recognize them because we were trying to find them in this forest that has lots of trees and twigs and all. It's a very, very hard terrain to find a tiny little bird. So listening out for calls, and I started to like form connections with the different species. I could recognize an agitation call from like a Pacific wren. The easiest one to recognize an agitation call from is probably a Steller's jay, because those are those blue and black birds, and they're jays. They're really related to crows and other corvids. So they just like they scream at you.
They're pretty loud.
They're so loud. They have so many different calls too, which is why they're amazing. But I really felt like I was part of a family. And most of them were annoyed at me because I was walking through the area, but it was really amazing.
Oh, but you were there to tell him that you're there to help. So
yeah, I was like, help me. I'm trying to save you. Like, like, tell me where you are. Stop hiding and yelling at me.
Right. So what would you say that you learned about yourself and your relationship with nature with this experience as a conservationist?
I learned a lot. I definitely learned a lot. I would say that I just gained so many more reasons for why it's so important to advocate and protect these species and these lands. I also saw how much of an effect it had on me, just how much it transformed me. The different experiences I had out there would really just make my week. And I was just like, so many people need to experience this. It would really, you know, it would solve so many issues. And I mean, it would really help out with mental health and just bringing people together. And to me is why it's so important to go out and recreate responsibly and to advocate for the protection of these lands. So, and like I was saying earlier, it felt like family. It felt like I was reconnecting with family. And you don't want anything bad to happen to your family. So that really boosted my drive for conserving these species, and it gave me a lot more reasons to. And I really wanted to better understand my role because of that. You know, I wanted to take more of a step back and realize, am I the best thing for, you know, these animals and these environments? And what can I do to be the best thing for these environments? And I think when you're considering that with different lands too, it's really important to look at that from the natural history of the land, which involves indigenous peoples, undoubtedly. So yeah, I mean, you really have to reimagine your role. And I think connecting with indigenous peoples to better understand, you know, how can we become stewards of this land as they've done since many, many years. And I think that incorporating the wisdom and judgment of indigenous peoples into conservation and wildlife is something that's going to be extremely important and is extremely important, not only now, but into the future as well, for not only these actual ecosystems, but, you know, for us, we're part of these ecosystems. You know, we're not separate. We've created these different urban cities and these different environments where we feel like we're completely disconnected from nature. But the truth of it is, we're still animals, and there's still that part of us within us that can connect to nature and reconnecting with our history and acknowledging, you know, the very real struggles and the very real things that occur and that still occur within us. And healing, you know, healing is such an important part of this. We have to heal to move forward. So I think it's really important that we communicate more with each other. We have people and conservationists and people who are, you know, using tools of Western science, communicate with indigenous peoples so that we're not perpetuating settler colonialism. And that's something that, you know, I think is very important. That should be an important aspect of everyone's, not only conservationists, but, you know, everyone's work. So that's something that's got to change within our education system. And sorry if I'm, you know, going down a rabbit hole, but yeah.
Redwoods Rising is a landscape scale project to restore 80,000 acres of previously logged recovering forests in Redwood National and State Parks. To learn more about this ambitious partnership between Save the Redwoods League, the National Park Service, and California State Parks, please visit redwoodsrising.org. And, you know, you brought up something really important, which I think every conservationist would agree, is that public education is essential to preserving wildlife.
Yeah.
And I think that you integrate art and science in such an innovative way that I'd love to talk now and switch gears about your TikTok educational videos. Would you share that with us?
So that's just something that that new app came out, and it was something that I saw was taken off, and I was like, wait, like first of all, I really like it because I can use video, like songs that normally if you were to put it on YouTube, it would get copyrighted very quickly and taken down. So I was like, yeah, I can use my favorite songs now. I realized that, you know, this would be a great avenue for me to share wildlife and conservation. it's just, it's so crazy to me because you could look at any different ecosystem and I guarantee you, you will find things there that are so interesting. They're so much more interesting than, you know, a majority of the time of the things we spend our time with. So I'm just trying to show people that nature is really cool and we should all appreciate it more and advocate for it.
Absolutely.
So yeah, I did a couple videos on there and just having fun, but trying to educate people at the same time and try to build a community of people to learn things and share. And yeah, it's been fun. I'm going to post something about some owls, some barred owls I saw in the field. Dubbed a little comedy sketch thing over that. And I think it's pretty funny.
Oh, great. I look forward to checking it out. Would you share with us your TikTok handle so other folks can see it? And folks, if you haven't had a chance, you have to check it out because my favorite is the one with the skunk family.
Oh my gosh.
So what's your TikTok handle?
Okay. Oh, it's sounds_wild. So just sounds_wild. And that's the same for Instagram too.
I think combining those three, technology, art, and science, definitely can foster and stimulate collaborations.
Yeah, definitely.
Would you like to share a little bit about how you see conservation using art to foster innovative thinking or stimulate collaborations?
Yeah. So I'm really interested in wildlife management, in conservation biology and conservation biology as a science. It's a multidisciplinary science. It incorporates like engineering and incorporates a lot of stuff on, it can like urban ecology and human aspects are always a part of it. And then you of course have all these different fields of science like geology, you have forestry and hydrology and botany. So there's all these different things, all these different sciences that can be incorporated into this. And there's room for art as well, because, you know, art is a media. It is a way we communicate and express. And so I think that going forward with conservation, we're going to have so many different ideas and so many different collaborations. Because for the big change that we need to happen, the big things to happen that we need for conservation, we need people to come together. Very large projects and things that, you know, span over large areas, such as the Save the Redwoods League and the projects that they're becoming a part of. It involves collaboration and people coming together. And that's why outreach is important. That's why finding creative ways for other people to connect to each other is important. And art is just such a powerful form to display a message. And you can even use art to display information. And going forward, conservation is going to just hopefully transform because we already have so much information about these areas that we want to protect. And it's important to continue that. But it's also equally important that we start acting. You know, even any scientific researcher can find new ways. There's always new ways to improve and to share that with people. And I think that if you're really devoted to saving these things or protecting these things, you have to realize the role that your voice might play in that. So I see conservation entering new fields. You know, I see, and I already see this. I see different conservationists making different videos and just, I've seen conservation artists before, and I know a couple, and the way that you can transform society by incorporating the things that you love, you know, about your life, such as art or dance, into that, it just, you know, it makes it something entirely new. And that's something that other people can recognize past just science.
Absolutely. I think it's definitely another tool, another vehicle to express yourself, to share your ideas, to educate. Mm-hmm. And I'm here for it. Mm-hmm. Okay, let's switch up a little before we end this segment with Tony. Tony, we're going to have a little fun and get to know you a little bit better by a lightning round of questions.
All right.
And as I mentioned, because it's a lightning round, it's going to be one word or maybe one sentence answers. So are you ready?
I'll try my best.
Okay, here we go. What animal are you?
I'm an owl.
If you were a pro baseball player, what would your theme song be when you're walking up to bat?
Oh, so easy. Key and Peele. It'd be the Key and Peele intro.
Oh gosh, I wish I knew what that was.
it's a Comedy Central show, and it's these two comedians and their duo, and it's just like, I'm singing Broad City. But it's just a very short.
I know that song. I know the Broad City theme song.
They're a duo, and it's just, it's very funny, and they're amazing, and they're funny. But yes, next question.
Okay, yeah, all right. Who inspires you?
Childish Gambino.
Three things you would want with you on a deserted island.
Oh, that's so hard. I think I've thought about this before, but a life straw. I'd want one of those straws that you can suck through and you get filtered water.
Okay.
Probably want a good knife, a very good knife, like a hori hori knife or something. I'm thinking about survival right now.
Okay, good, good.
Oh no, what's the third
one
thing?
More.
I don't know. I think I would maybe bring some paints or something, you know, something to keep me busy and make some art.
That's nice. Okay. Sounds good. Let's see. Favorite place in the world.
Oof, that's a tough one. That's a tough one. I really feel like it's right here. Yeah. I feel like Fern Canyon and Lady Bird Johnson, those two places right there.
Wow. Wonderful. Mm-hmm. What's your superpower?
Oh man. Flight. I can't fly, but you know, spiritually, metaphorically, I will fly.
Yes. What mythical creature do you wish was real?
Oh man, a dragon.
Yes.
Yeah. Some very. I love dragons.
That's a cool one. All right. Let's see. Now this is. I love this one. Are you ready for this one? Imitate a bird call right now.
Oh man. Ooh. 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 Ooh.
Ooh. Ooh. Great. What's that?
That was like a barred owl, maybe a spotted owl. Not very good. Not very good at all.
Cool. Okay. And now for the final question to bring us home. Explain to our listeners why they should experience the Redwoods.
Well, if you've never experienced what it's like to walk into a place and just be completely taken away, I would really recommend checking out the Redwoods, just because every time I go there, no matter what's going on in my life and what I'm stressed about, what I'm anxious about, I'm pretty anxious sometimes. It just has a magical way of transforming you into a different world, and not a different world, just connecting you to this world. And it's truly incredible. I mean, there's so many different things and so many different things to explore, but the trees, the redwood trees themselves, they have just hundreds of years of history, some even thousands, and seeing them and being able to be in their presence, it humbles you. It makes you into, you know, it transforms you. It transforms you. It's truly incredible. And I really recommend, if you are able to, finding a way to go see some redwoods. Yes.
Thank you. Yes, absolutely. I second that. Tony, it's been a pleasure getting to know you. And thank you so much for being part of Algo of Yugo team and family.
Of course.
And I wish you all the best in school your last year. And I know your future is bright. And I am so glad that we have you in this field of conservation.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. Stay connected by following us on Instagram and Twitter at Save the Redwoods and on Facebook at facebook.com/Save the Redwoods League.